Tantor Audio presents Touch, the Science of Hand, Heart, and Mind by David J. Linden. Narrated by John Pruden. If soul may look and body touch, which is the more blessed? W.B. Yeats, The Lady's Second Song, 1938. Seeing's believing, but feeling's the truth. Thomas Fuller, Nomologia, 1732. Prologue. Malibu, summer 1975. We're 8 teenage campers huddled around a fire ring late at night, piled up like puppies, spilling over rocks and stumps and the dusty bare dirt of the Santa Monica Mountains. We smell of black sage and acorns and unwashed t-shirts. With no adults in sight and the soft cover of darkness, we give voice to our innermost pubescent thoughts. Your turn, Sam. Okay, this is for Caroline. Would you rather give an open-mouth kiss to the camp director or eat a live cockroach? Our voices rise in a disgusted, delighted Greek chorus. Ew! You're so gross, Sam. I'm not answering that one. But you have to. Those are the rules. No way, you pervert. You're so prickly. I didn't mean to hurt your feelings. Yeah, right. Okay, here's a clean one. Would you rather die of cold in Antarctica or heat in the Sahara Desert? I'm not allowed to bring a parka to Antarctica? No, you're naked. Then I choose the desert. I want to go out with a good tan. Good-natured howling erupts. Caroline raises her arms and shimmies, vamping it up. Sam smiles. You're so vain, and I've got to go. Everyone knows that this is bogus. It's obvious that he's crazy about Caroline. No, you don't, you slippery son of a bitch. Now it's my turn. You must give up all of your senses except one. Which do you pick to save? Oh, man, that's rough. I'd keep sight. Then at least I could get around. No, hearing. I need my music. Shit, I don't know. That would just suck. Yeah, it would. I'm touched by your concern. Bite me. Later, lying in my sleeping bag and mulling over this flirtatious banter, I was puzzled. Flush with hormones, we all hungered for interpersonal touch, for kisses and caresses, and more. I was typical of this group, so consumed with the idea of holding and kissing a lovely dark-haired girl named Lorelei that I could barely speak. Touch was central to our obsessions and fantasies, yet none of us ever chose to preserve it when, in the nights that followed, Caroline's question about losing one of our senses returned in the "Would You Rather" game. Did we simply not think the ramifications through? It's certainly true that a bunch of horny, sleep-deprived, amped-up teenagers sitting around a campfire is not the ideal forum for contemplation. Or was it that we could easily imagine what it would be like to experience the loss of sight or hearing? We had all shut our eyes or plugged our ears, or even of taste or smell. Yet none of us had ever actually been able to recreate the sensation of the loss of touch. Perhaps touch was woven so deeply into our sense of self that we could not truly imagine life without it. Years later, when I read Lolita, I discovered that Vladimir Nabokov had, as usual, raised this very issue many years before. It is strange that the tactile sense, which is so infinitely less precious to men than sight, becomes at critical moments our main, if not only, handle to reality. For Nabokov's Umber, touch was so infinitely precious an experience that even the merest tactile contact with his beloved Lolita aroused overwhelming passions. For all of us, this experience of touch is intrinsically emotional, and this is reflected in common expressions in English. In the dialogue that opens this chapter, phrases like, "I'm touched by your concern," or "I didn't mean to hurt your feelings," and texture metaphors like, "You're so prickly," or "That's rough," or "You slippery son of a bitch," don't stand out at all. We are completely accustomed to describing a wide range of human emotions, actions, and personalities in terms of our skin senses. I was touched by her thoughtfulness. It's a sticky situation. That's enough of that coarse language. That is one hairy problem. He rubs me the wrong way. In everyday speech, the tactile is so entangled with the emotional that when we encounter someone who is emotionally clumsy, we call him tactless. Literally, he lacks touch. This may seem like a silly question, but it's not. Why are emotions called feelings and not sightings or smellings? Do touch metaphors really tell us something about the skin senses and their relationship to human cognition, or are they merely a common usage of present-day English? In fact, the constructions "I'm touched" to mean "I'm emotionally affected" and "my feelings" to mean "my tender emotions" have been in use in the language since at least the late 13th century. And such expressions are not unique to English or even the Indo-European language group, as they are found in tongues as diverse as Basque and Chinese. People who are blind or deaf from birth will, for the most part, develop normal bodies and brains, apart from the visual or auditory areas, and can live rich and fruitful lives. But deprive a newborn of social touch, as occurred in grossly understaffed Romanian orphanages in the 1980s and 1990s, and a disaster unfolds. Growth is slowed, compulsive rocking and other self-soothing behaviors emerge, and, if not rectified, emergent disorders of mood, cognition, and self-control can persist throughout adulthood. Fortunately, even a relatively minor intervention, an hour per day of touch and limb manipulation from a caregiver, can reverse this terrible course if applied early in life. Touch is not optional for human development. We have the longest childhoods of any animal. There is no other creature whose 5-year-old offspring cannot live independently. If our long childhoods are not filled with touch, particularly loving interpersonal touch, the consequences are dramatic. The critical role of touch in early development has not always been appreciated. Child-rearing advice of the 1920s from the psychologist John B. Watson, the founder of the psychological movement called behaviorism, cautioned parents about spoiling their children with physical affection. Let your behavior always be objective and kindly firm. Never hug and kiss them. Never let them sit on your lap. If you must, kiss them once on the forehead when they say goodnight. Shake hands with them in the morning. Give them a pat on the head if they have made an extraordinarily good job of a difficult task. While most partners today do not restrict contact with their children to an occasional pat on the head, it's a different story outside the family. In our zeal to protect kids from sexual predators, we have promoted no-touch policies for teachers, coaches, and other supervisory adults that, while well-meaning, have the inadvertent effect of adding to the touch deprivation of our children. As these kids have grown up in a touch-phobic environment and propagated these fears to their own children, our society as a whole has become further impoverished. You may ask, okay, I understand that kids are sensitive, but once we become adults, why does it matter if we're touch-deprived? This touchy-feely stuff is for hippies and time wasters. Just squirt out another glob of hand sanitizer with that deeply satisfying blorp sound and get back to work. The answer is that interpersonal touch is a crucial form of social glue. It can bind sexual partners into lasting couples. It reinforces bonds between parents and their children and between siblings. It connects people in the community and in the workplace, fostering emotions of gratitude, sympathy, and trust. People who are gently touched by a server in a restaurant tend to leave larger tips. Doctors who touch their patients are rated as more caring, and their patients have reduced stress hormone levels and better medical outcomes. Even people with clipboards at the mall are more likely to get you to sign their petitions or take their surveys if they touch your arm lightly. The main point of this book is not merely to argue that touch is good or even that touch is important. Rather, it's to explain that the particular organization of our body's touch circuits, from skin to nerves to brain, is a weird, complex, and often counterintuitive system, and the specifics of its organization powerfully influence our lives. From consumer choice to sexual intercourse, from tool use to chronic pain to the process of healing, the genes, cells, and neural circuits involved in the sense of touch have been crucial to creating our unique human experience. The transcendence of touch resides in the details, and of course these have been sculpted over the course of millions of years of evolution. They're in the dual function receptors in our skin that make mint feel cool or chili peppers hot. They're in the dedicated nerve fibers in our skin that predispose us to like a soft caress, but only if it moves at the proper speed across the skin. And they're in the brain's specialized centers for emotional touch, without which an orgasm would seem more like a sneeze, convulsive but not compelling. And lest we begin to think that everything's hardwired and predetermined, these same emotional touch centers are neural crossroads where sensation and expectation collide, allowing for powerful effects of life history, culture, and context. Activity in these brain regions determines whether a given touch will feel emotionally positive or negative, depending upon the context in which it occurs. Imagine a caress from your romantic partner during a sweet, quiet, connected time versus one that is administered right after he or she has said something deeply offensive. Similarly, these regions are where the neural signals engaged by the placebo effect, hypnotic suggestion, or even mere anticipation can act to dull or enhance pain. There is, in fact, no pure touch sensation, for by the time we have perceived a touch, it has been blended with other sensory input, plans for action, expectations, and a healthy dose of emotion. The good news is that these processes are no longer entirely mysterious. Recent years have seen an explosion in our scientific understanding of touch, revealing new ideas that help explain our sense of self and our experience of the world. So, let's dive in. The water's not so cold once you get used to it. It will feel great. Chapter 1. The Skin is a Social Organ. Warsaw, 1915. Solomon Ash was brimming with excitement. At the age of 7, he had been allowed to stay up past his usual bedtime for his first Passover Seder. In the warm glow of the candles, he watched his grandmother pour an extra glass of wine that didn't match a place setting. "Who's that glass for?" Solomon asked. "It's for the prophet Elijah," explained an uncle. "Will he really come inside and have some wine?" "Certainly," the uncle replied. "You just watch when the time comes, and we open the door to let him in." The extended family gathered around the table and read from the Haggadah, which tells the story of the Jews' liberation from slavery in Egypt in the time of Moses. Following the teachings of the Talmud, prayers were intoned, wine was drunk, parsley was dipped in salt water, and a festive meal was consumed while reclining in the manner of free people of the ancient world. After the meal, as tradition dictates, the front door was opened to admit the prophet. A moment later, Solomon, primed with expectation and inspired by the Passover ritual, saw the meniscus in the wine glass drop just a bit, as if Elijah had taken a single sip before slipping out the door to visit other Jewish families. Solomon Ash immigrated with his family to New York City at the age of 13 and soon learned English by reading the novels of Charles Dickens. As he grew older, he became fascinated with psychology, particularly social psychology, and earned his doctorate in that field in 1932 at Columbia University. Years later, he credited his interest in the field to his experience on that boyhood Passover night. How could the collective faith of the Seder celebrants lead him to believe in something like the prophet's sip of wine, which was demonstrably impossible? This was not just an academic question. With the rise of Hitler and Nazism in Europe, Ash became particularly concerned with two related socio-political questions that would hold his attention throughout his career. how can the social world shape our beliefs in the face of clear contradictory evidence? And how do we come to form rapid decisions about another's character? He wrote, "We look at a person and immediately a certain impression of his character forms in us. A glance, a few spoken words are sufficient to tell us a story about a highly complex matter. We know that such impressions form with remarkable rapidity and with great ease. Subsequent observation may enrich or upset our first view, but we can no more prevent its rapid growth than we can avoid perceiving a given visual object or hearing a melody." Ash wanted to know if there were underlying principles that guided this quick formation of character impressions. After all, everyone we encounter presents us with an array of diverse characteristics. One person is courageous, intelligent, with a ready sense of humor, and swift in his movements. But he is also serious, energetic, patient, and polite. Another is slow, deliberate, and serious, but has a fast temper when provoked. How do such perceived characteristics come together to form an overall impression of an individual and enable us to extrapolate and predict his behavior in various circumstances? Does each separate characteristic join together in a whole to form our perception? Or does one particular characteristic or a small cluster of them dominate our overall impression? Crucially, how do these processes play out for public figures like Hitler, Churchill, or Roosevelt, with whom few people interacted directly? In 1943, midway through World War II, Ash devised an experiment to begin to address these questions. He recruited subjects, mostly young women during these wartime years, from undergraduate psychology classes at various universities in New York City, such as Brooklyn College and Hunter College. "I shall read to you a number of characteristics that belong to a particular person," he told one assembled group. "Please listen to them carefully and try to form an impression of the kind of person described. You will later be asked to write a brief characterization of the person in just a few sentences. I will read the list slowly and will repeat it once. Intelligent, skillful, industrious, cold, determined, practical, cautious." A second group heard the same list with a single substitution. Cold was changed to warm. A sample response from someone forming an impression from the series including cold read, "A very ambitious and talented person who would not let anyone or anything stand in the way of achieving his goal. Wants his own way. He is determined not to give in, no matter what happens." A member of the warm group, in contrast, replied, "A person who believes certain things to be right, wants others to see his point, would be sincere in an argument, and would like to see his point won." The subjects were also asked to elaborate on their impression by picking one of a pair of opposite descriptive terms, like generous, ungenerous, sociable, unsociable, humane, ruthless, strong, weak, reliable, unreliable, or dishonest, honest, to describe the cold and warm individuals. When the responses were analyzed and the appropriate statistical tests applied, it became clear that the warm-cold distinction was very significant. The person described as warm was more often rated as generous, sociable, and humane, while the cold person was viewed as ungenerous, unsocial, and ruthless. The warm person was not, however, rated as more reliable, strong, or honest, indicating that the warm descriptor did not confer an across-the-board positive shift in impression. Rather, perceiving someone as warm indicates a specific constellation of traits: helpfulness, friendliness, and, most important, trustworthiness. Simply put, warm people are not identified as threats. Subsequent experiments and observations outside the laboratory by Ash and many others have shown that the warm-cold dimension is the strongest component of both the first impressions of individuals, the second strongest being competent-incompetent, as well as of group stereotypes when evaluated across many countries and cultures. Why do we respond so naturally to the linguistic metaphor of the warm individual? It is likely that this metaphor has deep biological roots. We often use terms familiar from our sensory experiences to organize abstract psychological concepts. In both our individual lives and our human evolutionary history, the physical sensation of warmth has been associated with security, trust, and an absence of threat, mostly through the experience of a mother's touch. Ash's model of impression formation suggests an obvious question. Does physical warmth relate to metaphorical warmth? Specifically, in adults, does the mere tactical experience of warmth on the skin activate feelings of interpersonal warmth that can transfer to our evaluation of an unknown person? To investigate this question, Lawrence Williams and John Barg of the University of Colorado and Yale, respectively, devised a clever experiment. Subjects were met in the lobby of the psychology building by an employee of the experimenters. This employee, who crucially was blind to the intent of the study, was carrying an awkward load, a cup of coffee, a clipboard, and two textbooks. During the elevator ride up to the lab on the fourth floor, she casually asked each subject to hold her coffee cup while she recorded the subject's information on a form attached to the clipboard. She then took the coffee cup back and delivered the subject to the experimenters. In some cases, the cup contained hot coffee, and in others, iced coffee. When the subjects arrived in the lab, they were immediately given a personality assessment questionnaire like that used in Ash's original 1943 study, but without the warm-cold terms. For example, Person A was described as intelligent, skillful, industrious, determined, practical, and cautious. They were then asked to rate this fictional person on the 10 traits using the previously described method of opposites: humane, ruthless, dishonest, honest, and so on. They found that subjects who had held the hot coffee perceived the target person as being significantly warmer, humane, trustworthy, friendly, than those who had held the cup of iced coffee. Remarkably, the brief experience of physical warmth on the skin of the hands did indeed promote interpersonal warmth. Is the influence of incidental tactile experience on our evaluation of an unknown person unique to warmth, for which we have an unusually strong positive emotional association, or does it apply more broadly to touch sensations in general? Could other skin sense experiences subconsciously influence our impressions about unrelated people and situations? Guided by rich tactile metaphors in the English language, like weighty matters, the gravity of the situation, smooth negotiation, and hard bargainer, John Barg, now joined by Joshua Ackerman and Christopher Nocera, set out to test this broader hypothesis. First, they had passers-by evaluate a single job candidate by reviewing a resume affixed to either a light or a heavy clipboard, 340 grams versus 2,041 grams, the latter being the weight of a typical medium-sized laptop computer. Subjects given the heavy clipboard rated the candidate as significantly better overall and as showing more interest in the position. The tactile experience of the weighty clipboard subconsciously caused the job applicant to be perceived as having significantly better performance and more serious intent. Importantly, the weighty clipboard did not influence subconscious impressions generally. For example, the candidate was not rated as more or less likely to get along with coworkers. Rather, the heavy clipboard specifically conferred gravitas. Barg's group moved on to explore texture, influenced by metaphors like, "I had a rough day." In this study, passers-by were first asked to complete a simple jigsaw puzzle, one group being given a puzzle in which the pieces were covered in sandpaper, and the other group an identical puzzle with smooth pieces. All subjects were then asked to read a passage describing an interaction in which the social valence of the situation was deliberately ambiguous. When subjects were asked to rate the quality of the interaction in the passage, the rough texture subjects scored it as significantly more adversarial versus friendly, more competitive versus cooperative, and more like an argument than a discussion. The physical experience of a rough texture changed evaluations of a social interaction to make it seem more metaphorically rough. Finally, a similar study was conducted using hard versus soft as the tactile manipulation. Here, the psychologists disguised the touch experience by embedding it in the ongoing patter of a magic act. Passers-by were asked to watch a magic trick and guess its secret. As a part of the show, subjects were asked to examine an object to be used in the trick, ostensibly to confirm that it had not been tampered with. Some subjects fondled a soft swatch of blanket, others a hard block of wood. The magic act was then postponed while the subjects were asked to read the same deliberately ambiguous social interaction passage used in the rough smooth study, with the difference being that they were told that the interaction was between an employee and a boss. When asked to evaluate the employee, subjects primed with the wood block were significantly more likely to rate him or her as rigid and strict, consistent with hardness as a metaphor for an unyielding, unemotional personality. And no, sadly, the subjects never actually got to see the magic trick. The fact that even incidental touch experience can influence our impressions of people and our social interactions can be more than a little disconcerting. How would that beautiful, intelligent woman I was chatting up at the Café Med in Berkeley in 1983 have reacted if she had had her hand wrapped around a hot cup of coffee instead of that cold Italian soda? And what about that weird department chairman who compulsively squeezed a hollow rubber ball while he interviewed me for an academic job? If he had been toying with a letter opener, would he have tended to regard me as sharper or merely hard and unyielding? While the BARG incidental touch studies were well designed and their findings are useful and interesting, they do have serious limitations. Most important, they do not capture impressions as they occur in real-world situations. Survey-based experiments require that subconsciously formed impressions be made conscious and explicit, and the responses of the subjects must conform to the experimenter's predetermined scales of measurement. This is an unnatural situation. In our daily lives, we are continually forming ideas about people and situations, but are not simultaneously making mental checklists assessing them on the basis of humane versus ruthless or discussion versus argument. That's why it's important to investigate the social roles of touch in everyday contexts. With its complex social milieu, clear measures of team and individual performance, and plenty of butt-slapping, high-fives, and chest bumps, there is no better tactile social living laboratory than the National Basketball Association, NBA. This was the insight of a research group at UC Berkeley composed of Michael Krauss, Cassie Huang, and Dacher Keltner. They reasoned that since interpersonal touch can promote trust and cooperation, two important factors for a successful basketball team, increased touch between teammates early in the season should predict more cooperative behavior and better performance as the season unfolds. To measure this, Krauss and co-workers first watched videotapes of games featuring all 30 NBA teams, 294 players were involved, in the early part, the first 2 months, of the 2008-2009 season. They scored the occurrence, type, and duration of celebratory touching, fist bumps, leaping shoulder bumps, high tens, and so on, that followed a player's making a successful shot. For these same games, the researchers also produced ratings using an index of cooperative behaviors, including talking to teammates, passing the ball, and setting screens, that is, behaviors that showed a reliance on teammates, sometimes at the expense of one's own individual performance. To measure individual and team performance over the course of the season, they turned to statistics maintained by the NBA and distributed freely on its website. When the data were crunched and the appropriate statistical tests run, there was a clear result. Celebratory touch during games early in the season was associated with higher performance throughout the season for both individual players and teams. But might this association come about trivially? For example, what if the best players and teams simply score more often and therefore have more cause to celebrate with touch? That would change the interpretation of the touch-performance correlation. To address this possibility, Krauss and his colleagues applied a statistical correction to adjust for the total numbers of points scored, but the touch-performance correlation still held strongly for both teams and individuals. But what if teams that were predicted at the outset of the season to do well, in polls of coaches or sportscasters, were more optimistic, and it was this factor that led to more celebratory touching and better performance? Again, the predictive power of early season touch on performance remained after applying a statistical correction based on early season predictions, as well as another correction based on player status, using salary as a proxy measure. Finally, when the cooperation scores were analyzed, it emerged that cooperation largely accounts for the relationship between touch and enhanced performance. While investigations of this type cannot prove causality, the correlations in this study strongly indicate that, at least within the context of professional basketball, brief celebratory touch enhances individual and group performance and does so by building cooperation. But for those of us who don't play in the NBA, what social functions are served by interpersonal touch? Is social touch always intended to foster trust and cooperation? A good way to start approaching these questions is to examine certain of our closest primate cousins: baboons, chimpanzees, bonobos, and vervet monkeys. These species live in large social groups and have many eyes and ears directed at the perimeter of their territory to detect approaching trouble and to keep themselves safe from predators. There is also strength in numbers, for while an adult leopard can almost always prevail in a fight with a single baboon, groups of baboons have been reported to drive leopards up a tree and even, occasionally, to kill them. Many of these large social units are situated in places with ready access to food. The stability afforded by a low risk from predation and plenty of food gives baboons lots of free time to engage in complex social lives. For instance, Robin Dunbar reports that gelada baboons living in the Ethiopian highlands spend up to 20% of their waking hours fussing over the skin and fur of other geladas. That's a huge investment of time in grooming behavior. While grooming is useful to remove dead skin, parasites, tangled hairs, and bits of plant material, the time that gelada baboons and many other primate species devote to this task is far out of proportion to the health benefits that accrue from having well-tended skin and fur. The main reason for extended grooming is social, not dermatological. Gelada live in large troops, typically numbering 100 to 400 individuals. But within each troop are many smaller social units, harems consisting of four or five females, their young offspring, and a single breeding male. When young gelada reach puberty, the males in a harem will depart to join a bachelor group, but the females will remain, assuring that the social core of the harem is a group of related females, mothers, sisters, aunts, and female cousins. These harem females form a loyal and long-lasting coalition that is strengthened and maintained by extensive grooming. Their sisterly solidarity is displayed in a number of ways, but none is more amusing than when a member of the coalition is threatened by a domineering male. The single breeding male in the harem must consistently police his females to keep them from having sex with the younger males of the bachelor groups who are always loitering nearby. In addition to scaring off the bachelors, the breeding male will often attempt to intimidate a straying female of his harem with a charge and threat display, panting and teeth grinding. At this point, her relatives race to the rescue, ganging up to chase off the breeding male. But within the female coalition, not all relationships are equal, and some bonds are stronger than others. In an inter-harem squabble, a female will ally herself with her most avid grooming partner. In these primate social groups, grooming is as laden with social meaning as choosing their lunch table companions is for high school students. Mothers groom their offspring. Mating partners groom each other. Friends groom friends, in both male and female pairs. And, just as in high school, the higher status primates receive more grooming attention than they give. A network of loyalty is created and reinforced by grooming. So coalition members are more likely to come to the aid of one of their group when he or she is confronted by another in the harem or in the larger group, or even by a predator. Using recording and playback equipment in the field, it has been shown that chimpanzees and macaque monkeys are more likely to respond to a distress call, thereby putting themselves in danger, when the call was recorded from an animal with which they recently groomed. A young male chimpanzee or baboon may seek to curry favor with the breeding male by grooming him or by establishing a grooming-based alliance with another young male to seek to overthrow the breeding male. If he succeeds in overthrowing the king, it is to his advantage to make a gesture to the deposed monarch to reduce the chance that he will attack in a bid to regain his former status. If he is clever, he might even get the former king to become an ally in fending off other males during the days of transition. If the deposed king believes that he cannot regain his status, it is to his advantage to reconcile as well, as he would like to remain in the group to protect his last batch of offspring, even if his breeding days are now over. There's a ritual for this reconciliation. The victor presents his rear end to the deposed male, who then reaches through the new monarch's legs to lightly touch his penis. With those formalities concluded, the pair grooms each other like long-lost friends to seal the deal. So the situation is not dissimilar for human NBA players and certain non-human primates like gelada baboons. Social touch tends to reinforce cooperation and loyalty. Human and non-human primates alike use grooming and other forms of social touch to soothe, reconcile, form alliances, reward cooperative actions, and reinforce bonds of kinship and friendship. Has this type of behavior appeared only in the primate lineage, or are there traces of it in other animals as well? There is at least one notable example of social grooming and cooperation in a non-primate. The common vampire bat, Desmodus rotundus, takes wing at night to feed on the blood of living mammals, most commonly horses, burros, cattle, and tapirs. This is their only food source, because their narrow throats cannot accommodate solid food. If the animal they are feeding upon has fur, they will use their canine and cheek teeth to carefully shave away a patch prior to piercing the skin with sharp upper incisors to start bleeding. The bat's saliva contains an anticoagulant compound that keeps the blood flowing for the 20 to 30 minutes of lapping needed to consume.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.